Thank you very much, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm really pleased to be invited to talk about this theme of the next 40 years. How are we going to feed 9.6 billion people? Feed them better than today, at reasonable cost, and without damaging the environment. But let's look first at the magnitude of the challenge. The Population Reference Bureau's projections have the world's population growing by almost 2.6 billion in the next 40 years, actually in the next 38 years. 2.6 billion, the way to put that in perspective is, remember, the population of China today is 1.3 billion. So in other words, the world's farmers are being asked to produce enough more food in the next 38 years to feed the equivalent of two more Chinas. That's not a trivial challenge. When we look at where that population growth is occurring, if you look in the third column from the left, the big increases in population are in sub-Saharan Africa, the only region of the world whose population is projected to more than double, and in South Central Asia, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Nepal. So we have immense challenges of expanding food production in those areas where there's virtually no additional land available that can be brought into production. There, in addition to the population growth itself, which is expanding the demand for food, another factor that's contributing significantly to increasing demand for food is the changing diets that occur when people move from rural areas to the cities. Just a couple of years ago, for the first time in the history of humanity, more than half of the world's population was living in cities. The UN Population Office projects that will grow to 60% by 2030, 70% by 2050. So again, a huge challenge in how we provision the cities with 70% of the world's population, as well as the dietary change that accompanies expansion of urban populations. And on top of all of this, the critical factor, of course, is growth in purchasing power. 1.4 billion people in the world, live on less than $1.25 a day, according to World Bank estimates. 2.6 billion on less than $2 a day. There are 1 billion people in the world who, according to FAO's estimates, can't afford even 1,800 calories per day, not enough to put in a medium level of physical activity. But by $2 a day, most people can afford enough calories. But as you move from two up to about $10 per day, this is the range of income rise where you have the maximum rate of expansion of demand for raw agricultural products coming from the farm. Because after about $10 per day per capita, any increment income that still gets spent on food tend to be spent on value-added services after the product left the farm. But with this projected expansion of the middle class, particularly in developing countries, by 160% by 2020, that's with almost no increase in middle class in the high income countries, approaching 1 billion households, we're going to have a huge increase in the number of households that it can afford to eat more meat, more dairy products, more poultry products, more fruits, more vegetables, more edible oils. All these taken together lead me to the conclusion that world demand for food will increase somewhere between 70% and 80% by 2050, 40% increase in population growth, 30% to 40% additional increase in demand from broad-based economic growth and urbanization in low-income countries. Okay, if the world's farmers need to produce something approaching doubling of demand for food, where is this going to come from? There's at most 12% more arable land worldwide that isn't presently forested or subject to erosion desertification on which to produce almost twice as much food. And we know that with urbanization, we're paving over more and more prime agricultural land. As cities expand, we know that there's degradation of many soils occurring, reducing their productive potential. Now, we could double the number of acres of land in production worldwide, but only at the cost of massive destruction of forests, and with it loss of wildlife habitat, loss of biodiversity, reduction in carbon sequestration capacity, accelerating global climate change. This leads me to the conclusion, when there's at most 10% more land available that isn't presently forested, that the only environmentally sustainable alternative is one in which we do something close to doubling the average productivity of the fertile, non-erodible soils that are already in crop production. But the land constraint perhaps isn't even the most binding constraint, because farmers are estimated to use 70% of the fresh water used in the world today. And remember the projected increase in urban population to 70% of the world's population by 2050. If 70% of the world's population is living in cities, farmers are not going to have access to 70% of the world's fresh water. Cities are already outbidding farmers for available water in some places, and this is only likely to increase as the rate of urbanization grows. So the world's farmers, being called upon to almost double food production, are going to have to do it using less water than they're using today. In fact, they may have to even come close to tripling the crop per drop, or the average productivity of the water they use. And this is certainly going to require adoption of any available technologies to improve the efficiency of water use, but it'll also surely require increased investments in agriculture research to increase the drought tolerance of the crops, as well as to improve the water use efficiency of the crops being produced. So sustainability in the future is really going to require increased global food system productivity. Where we can, we need to make unusable soils productive. In fact, the 10 to 12% additional land that might be brought into production worldwide is all inferior to that already in production, and most of it's located far from service by infrastructure. Where we can, we need to increase the genetic potential of crops we're producing, of our animal production systems, our farming systems in general. Once we have that genetic potential, we need to achieve as much of it as we can by improving the nutrition of the crops or nutrition of the animals that we're producing, increasing the water availability, efficiency of use, invest in irrigation where we can around the world. Once we've got the genetic potential of crops and that they're well fed and well watered, we need to reduce competition from weeds for the water, the nutrients, as well as sunlight, and to reduce losses from disease and insects, and perhaps something that's often forgotten, reduce post-harvest losses. It's estimated that as much as one-third of all the food we produce in the world never makes it into our stomachs. That at least a third of the production in many low-income countries is lost to rodents, insects, rotting, just physical losses in the transportation system. And of course, in high-income countries, we waste an awful lot of food after post-retail between the time we take it home from the supermarket and eat it or in restaurants. So we can make a huge increase in the global food system productivity by improving or reducing our post-harvest losses. But virtually all of these are going to take more investments in agriculture research. But that's not the only challenge we confront. The other one, of course, is climate change. And we expect to have greater increases in temperature over land than over water, and the greatest increase at the highest latitudes. We expect to see the spatial distribution of precipitation increase, probably with the largest reduction in the subtropics, the largest increase in higher latitudes, perhaps an increase under the monsoons. But I think many climate scientists are reaching the conclusion that the increase in temperature and the increased spatial distribution of precipitation may not be the biggest challenges. It may very well be the increased frequency of extreme events, such as droughts, flooding, etc., that may be the biggest challenge to agricultural output in the future. But with all agroecosystems shifting with climate change, and when we recognize the location specificity of many agricultural technologies, we're going to need more adaptive agriculture research just to sustain present productivity, not to mention the need to something close to double the average productivity of the land in production and perhaps triple the average productivity of the water we use in agriculture. Now, there is a lot more productivity enhancement potential from classical plant and animal breeding, especially when combined with modern genomics. And genetic engineering also opens additional frontiers, such as improving the nutritional content of grains, increasing drought tolerance, tolerance to flooding, tolerance to extreme temperatures, to salt, to aluminum toxicity. Where we can, there's potential internalized resistance to diseases and viruses. and perhaps one of the most important environmental outcomes of using this technology in research is to reduce pesticide use, particularly insecticides, by breeding in natural resistance to pesticides. Herbicide-resistant varieties tend to reduce the energy intensity of production, it reduces the labor costs, and of course there may very well be potential applications in slowing down product deterioration as well. But there are many other areas of agriculture research potential. Low-till agriculture has resulted in huge environmental benefits to date, has the potential to even further increase carbon sequestration in the soils in agriculture production. Precision agriculture, to be sure we get the necessary amount of water and of crop nutrients onto the soil where they're needed, not over-fertilize, but get the right amount of nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, and micronutrients into the root zone of the plant when it needs it, not overfeed it so we have runoff or percolation down into groundwater. With application of computers and modern data processing technologies and information and electronic sensors, we're able to further enhance the precision agriculture. Nanotechnology seems to have some significant potential. And of course, there are many other areas of science where there's great potential to benefit humanity by increasing agriculture productivity to ensure that we can feed the world's larger population at reasonable cost. But this is going to take investments in both public sector as well as private agriculture research. The private sector has been asked to carry the load to do more and more of the agriculture research as public support for agriculture research has been cut back. With the ability of the private sector to protect the intellectual property, it's been able to recoup the cost of research in the products it sells to farmers. But perhaps the pendulum has swung too far in relying as much on the private sector and as we've cut back on our public support. So, and this is not least true because there are many areas of research in which the private sector will invest less than the social optimum in agriculture research. In basic research, the payoff is frequently too far in the future and too uncertain for the private sector to do the socially optimum amount. Where it's hard to protect intellectual property, such as open pollinated varieties, or where no market exists, like investments in research on conservation or in public policy. There are other reasons why public investment is needed as well, such as no individual farm can capture all the benefits from research, the scale of investment needed is huge, and the ultimate benefit of investments in agriculture research that we've made over the last 100 to 150 years in this country and around the world is that most of the benefits eventually accrue to consumers. In fact, we had a 150-year decline in the real cost of food as a result of the productivity enhancement that's occurred, with the greatest beneficiaries being the lowest income consumers, both in the United States and around the world. The lowest income consumers are the greatest beneficiaries because, of course, it's they who spend the largest fraction of their income on food. The higher the income of a consumer, the lower the fraction spent on food. So the low income consumers get a huge benefit. And finally, the universities need to be involved in publicly supported agriculture research because they're training the next generation of PhD scientists that need to be employed by both the private sector as well as the public sector in doing the research of the future. If the universities don't have public support for agriculture research, they're simply not going to have the tools to train the next generation of scientists to the cutting edge of science or cutting edge of knowledge. This graph, developed by the Economic Research Service at the Department of Agriculture, plots the changes in investments in public and private R&D in agriculture since the 1970s. And we see that private investments passed public investments already before 1980, when public investments started to flatten out. And we've seen generally, particularly investments in productivity-enhancing agriculture research, stagnate over these last several decades, while the private sector has picked up more of the research. But I would argue that we've let the pendulum swing too far, and we need to bring it back to have greater balance between both the public and the private sector. We need them both. And it's not only here in the United States that we've seen waning support for agriculture research. Agriculture has really been off the global development agenda around the world over the last several decades. Agriculture and rural development were top priorities in our foreign aid program, as well as in lending by the World Bank and other international development banks, really up until the 1980s. I think people in general recognize that the majority of the extreme poverty in the world is in rural areas, and most of those people are farmers. So if we're going to address the problems of poverty around the world, we had to develop those rural areas to reduce poverty where the bulk of it resided. In addition, I think everybody recognized the food challenges of the low-income countries of the world and the reliance that many of them had come to have on food aid. And there was a feeling that there, from both the standpoint, or from the dual objectives of reducing poverty as well as increasing food security in low-income countries, we needed to invest more of our foreign aid resources in agriculture. But between 1980 and early in this century, we saw the fraction of our foreign aid, the USAID, drop to minuscule level. We saw lending by the World Bank also fall. We saw investments by other countries' foreign aid programs and also the low-income countries themselves. But perhaps most problematical is the fact that I put in bold type at the bottom of this slide. The share of foreign aid and of development bank lending that's been invested in agriculture research has been cut by an even larger percentage during this period than investments in agriculture development more generally. This graph shows the change that's occurred over the last several decades as the fraction of foreign aid as well as international development bank lending that's gone to agriculture has plummeted. This began a small turnaround after the price spike and the world food price crisis of 2008, when we saw food riots in more than three dozen countries. We saw one head of state overthrown because of food insecurity. But in the current budget environment, both here in the United States as well as in Western Europe, it's imperative that we not lose the progress that's been made here, because if we're really serious about Millennium Development Goal number one of cutting poverty and hunger in half in the world by 2015, we've got to redouble our efforts in rural areas, and particularly in agriculture development and in diffusing presently available technologies, as well as investing in research to solve the problems of those countries and to improve and to increase our potential for dealing with climate change as it occurs. So my last slide to the long-term prospects. Late in the 18th century, a British minister by the name of Thomas Malthus wrote his famous tract in which he projected that population growth would outstrip growth in food supply around the world, and that ultimately starvation would starve the world's population. Well, Malthus has been wrong for more than two centuries because he underestimated the power of agriculture research to raise productivity faster than demand has grown, and as a result, we had a 150-year downward trend in the real price of grain to the great benefit of the lower-income members of our society as well of other societies around the world. Now we're challenged to do something close to doubling world agricultural production with a 70% to 80% growth projected in world food demand, as well as the likelihood that we'll use some agricultural commodities to produce biofuels, resulting in the likelihood of probably needing to double production in total worldwide. Whether the world market price of agricultural products and food resumes its long-term downward trend, stabilizes at a higher plateau, or increases through the 21st century will depend almost entirely on whether we invest enough in the public and the private sectors to raise productivity of our land and our water faster than global demand for agricultural output grows. There's no more excuse for Malthus to be right in the 21st century than he was in the 20th or the 19th century. But he'll only continue to be wrong in the 21st century if we do redouble our commitment to investments in agriculture research. Failing that, we'll see the number of people hungry in the world increase as rising food costs further reduce the purchasing power of the minuscule incomes of the world's poor. So the future really depends upon us in the high-income world, in the United States, as well as Western Europe and in Japan and Oceania, whether we make the commitment or not in both our domestic appropriations as well as in our appropriations for foreign aid to invest in agriculture research.